Okay, my second story, then, speaking of being pushed out, has to do with what we see in cities across the nation. Just a few days ago in East St. Louis, last week in Scranton, Seattle more recently, a little bit less recently, Chicago a couple of years ago, British Columbia about a year before that. Teachers are going on strike. And in our nation, striking teachers has certainly been less common over the past few decades. But at the time that the Chicago teachers went on strike 2 years ago, all we needed to do was look around the world to see that teachers were striking all over the world, right? There were teacher strikes happening in, I believe, about 7 or 8 nations at the exact time that Chicago was going on strike. Now, what's happening right now? Well, one of the things that's happening is that unions are engaging in different strategies. Right? We could argue that in the past few decades, labor has adopted a much more conciliatory strategy. Labor's strategy was often to try to compromise more. Right? And in fact, this was one of the reasons why the caucus, the radical caucus within Chicago, ran and was able to take over the leadership of Chicago 3 years ago. It was because they argued that the leadership of the union was too much about compromise and not enough about fighting for what we knew needed to change. Right? When we think about labor then, what we see is a return to strategies that actually characterized labor initiatives and labor tactics about half a century ago. When unions were at their peak, really before the civil rights movement, union strategies was much more about political education of its members. It was much more about collectivizing and mobilizing and movement building. It was not so much about compromising around policy issues. Right? And that is what I would argue we saw in Chicago, and that is what I would argue we're seeing increasingly in unions across the world, which is where collectives of teachers are less about compromising on policies and much more about shifting the public debate about what is wrong with the direction of school reforms. One of the things that I found so powerful about the British Columbia strike that preceded all of the most recent strikes here in the United States was exactly this strategy. When you look at what the British Columbia Union was putting out there, what they were saying is, look, compensation is one of many things that we are struggling over, that we see the strike as part of a larger effort to push back against the reforms happening in our nation's schools. And this is exactly what Chicago did, right? Every time the Chicago teacher leaders went up in front of the media, they said, we are striking to push back against many of the reforms coming our way, right? The strike is part of a larger struggle. And this is what we heard in Seattle. This is what we're hearing in Scranton. This is what I believe we're hearing in East St. Louis as well, is that the strike is part of a larger effort. And are we as educators consistently situating our work as part of larger social movements? Speaking of larger movements, let me then talk about what's happening in the nation. So Duncan announces his resignation. He's going to step down in December. And the replacement is John King. I know that was such a dramatic pause, right? But John King is the replacement for Artie Duncan. So who is John King? All right. So John King, from 2011 to end of 2014, was the commissioner of New York schools. And at the beginning of 2015, he was appointed by Duncan to be the number 2 at the Department of Education. And after Duncan resigns in December, he will be the acting secretary of education. And he will be the acting secretary, and what we're hearing is that Obama will likely not, or does not have plans to nominate him, which means that King will not need to go through a confirmation process, which means that he will serve as the acting secretary for the final year of Obama's administration. Now, why would this happen? Why are we not going to go through a confirmation process? Well, some might say, well, he only has a year left. But many of us, of course, would argue that a year is a very long time, right? Some people like to say that it takes about 3 years to transform an institution and about 3 months to completely dismantle it. A year is a lot of time to continue to exert the kind of damage that we've seen under the Duncan administration. What I would argue with is that this is not merely about what is easy for the final year of a presidency. This really is about avoiding what could be a very contentious national debate. Because if King went through the confirmation process, what this does is it opens up for Congress the debates about whether or not the direction of the Department of Ed is something that we want to continue. Right? Congress, we know, is really quite critical of the Department of Education. Both the Republicans and the Democrats are saying that we have overly focused on testing so much that it's destroying our nation's public schools. And one of the pieces of evidence that Congress is really quite unhappy is with the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act. So I'm hoping that all of you are following that right now Congress is finally taking up the reauthorization of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, right? What was called No Child Left Behind under George Bush. It is 14 years, it is far long overdue for its reauthorization. So the Elementary and Secondary Education Act was a civil rights legislation. It was launched in 1965, primarily as a way for the federal government to push the states to comply with non-discrimination law and to address inequities in our nation's public schools. In this reauthorization of ESCA, one of the things that we see, just a little bit of more information by the way, so both the House and the Senate has passed their versions of this bill, and right now it's in conference as they try to come up with a compromise. And many people expect that this fall, this will be one of the things that Congress moves on. Okay. What we see in both bills is a move to weaken the Department of Education. Right? So both bills are saying that the Department of Education should not be able to tell states how to use tests. Congress, by the way, still wants annual testing. They just don't want the Department of Ed to tell the states how to use those test scores. Okay. And this is one of many examples of how Congress does not want the Department of Education to have the ability to push states. I'm not going to argue that the move of the Department of Education over the past 7 years to increase the amount of testing we do and the amount of stakes that we place on testing is a very damaging thing for our nation's schools. But what I would argue is that the weakening of the Department of Education is not the solution, right? It is amnesia to forget that the whole reason we created ESCA was to strengthen the ability of the federal government to push the states, most of whom were not complying with federal non-discrimination law, right? We cannot weaken the ability of the federal government to continue to push on those issues. What I would argue we would continue to see under the King administration is what we're seeing right now in the Duncan administration, right? King, in many ways, is Duncan times two, right? Because under the King administration in New York, what we saw was an increase in privatization and of charter schools. We saw an increase in testing, and we saw an increase in the use of those tests to make high-stakes decisions. In fact, the teachers' union did a historic vote of no confidence of King. The parents were calling for his removal, and within months after he stepped down and was rescued by Duncan to move into the Department of Ed, 200,000 students in New York boycotted the tests. Students, parents, and teachers are pushing back against King, and we should be asking, why then is this the next leader of our nation's public education system? Right? We should be demanding that there be a confirmation here. We should be demanding that there be debates, and perhaps most important, we should be demanding that other names be considered. We should be demanding that the leadership of education be someone who truly embodies the values that we hold so dear for our nation's public education system, right? This reminds me, by the way, one time I was at a lecture and the noted New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman was the keynote speaker. And he began his talk by saying, the purpose of public schools is to prepare people to be competitive in the job market, right? So I'm gonna spend my talk telling you how schools can do that better. And at the end of the talk, he got a standing ovation from an audience that I think would be an audience that really wants to see schools be more democratic. And so as he was getting the standing ovation, I looked around the room and I thought to myself, sit down, like, what are you all doing? We should not be giving this guy a standing ovation because the purpose of education is not merely to prepare children to be competitive in the future for jobs. That is perhaps one goal of education. argue that education is about preparing us to be participants in a democratic society. I would argue that education is about preparing us to be well and to be happy. And I would also argue, by the way, that I don't believe that education is merely about preparing children for something in the future. I also believe that education is about children and young people in the here and now. And if we only think about students as future adults, we lose out on all that they have to offer right now. Grace Lee Boggs argues that what we need is a paradigm shift. What we need is to think outside of the narratives that dominate common sense today. And here I draw on some of the great work of sociolinguists like George Lakoff, who wrote one of my favorite books that I think many of you are familiar with. It's called Don't Think of an Elephant. Don't Think of an Elephant. Great short book, by the way. I would encourage all of you to add that to your must-read pile. So George Lakoff is a sociolinguist professor at Berkeley, and he tells a story of how sometimes he likes to begin his courses by saying, all right, I want you all not to think of an elephant. And then, of course, you find yourself thinking of an elephant. And that's kind of his point, right? That how you begin a conversation shapes your engagement with that conversation. It's like what we tell debate teams, those of you who've coached debate teams or are on debate teams, right? Frame the debate. Because if you can get your opponent talking about an issue on your terms, you've kind of won half the battle. Lakoff gives the example of about 15 years ago when people were pushing for tax cuts. Those who were pushing for tax cuts made this really brilliant move when they got everyone to use the term tax relief. Because if I start talking about tax relief, and I'm not in favor of tax cuts, the most I can do is debate with you whether to give you a little bit of relief or a lot of relief, right? That's not a winning debate. That's not a debate I should be participating in at all. My job actually needs to be to reframe that debate. I need to use a different conceptual framework, a different metaphor to talk about an issue. So Lakoff argues, instead of talking about taxes as something I need relief from, what if I talked about taxes as a form of investment in the future? It's a very different way to talk about taxes, and that's our job, right? In fact, as educators, what bigger job do we have than to shift the things that have become common sense, to get us to question what often goes unquestioned? Here, I think about this great story that was told by the fantastic law professor at Harvard named Lonnie Guinier. So Guinier wrote a book with Gerald Torres in 2004 called The Miner's Canary, and there's a story I want to tell that comes from this book. So Lonnie Guinier tells a story of being at a family party, and they're out in the backyard, and there's all these young children, and they're playing this a game. It's a relay race. It's girls versus boys, and it's this race where you have to carry a golf ball or an egg in a spoon, and you run a little bit and pass the egg to the next person, and that person runs, and they pass it to the next person, and whichever team can get the ball to the other side of the yard first wins. So as I said, it was girls versus boys. The girls won. So the boys demanded a rematch, and then the girls won again. So on the sidelines were all these professor types, all these Guinier types, and Guinier jokes, you know, what do we professor types like to do best in a situation like this? Well, we like to sit on the sidelines and analyze everything that's going on. So that's exactly what they're doing, right? And they're asking questions like, why are the girls winning? Like, are they more coordinated? Are they more patient? And what's up with the boys? Like, why are they unable to compete? She says at one point, the conversation paused when one of the grandmothers asked, well, who chose this game? And it was at that point that Guinier realized or remembered that when we're trying to make sense of a problem, we tend to only ask certain kinds of questions, and that perhaps the most important questions that we should be asking are those we never ask. She argues that when we're trying to make sense of a problem, there are three questions we should be asking. The first is the most commonly asked question. It's the question that the parents were asking, and that question is, who is winning and who is losing? And we tend to ask who is winning and who is losing because we want to figure out what the winners are doing so that we can help the losers to better compete. In other words, our goal is often to fix the losers. There's a second kind of question we should be asking, though, and that's the question that the grandmother was asking. Who made the rules? Who made the rules? Because Guinier reminds us that it's often people in positions of power who make the rules, and we often make them in ways that advantage us. And this isn't to say, again, that girls are naturally more coordinated or more patient. But it is to say that it's not surprising that they chose a game in which they were more likely to succeed, and in fact in which they did succeed, twice. Well, there's a third question that we should be asking that is perhaps the most important, and that is the least frequently asked. And that question is, what is the story that we tell the losers to make them want to continue playing? What is the story that we're all buying into? In this situation, the boys saw that the girls chose the game, they saw that they were losing, but they still insisted on a rematch. They were still buying into the story that this game is fair and that they have a chance to win. Now, in education, Rainier makes me wonder, are we asking all three questions? Because what I would argue is we tend to ask most frequently the first, who is winning and who is losing. And we tend to think that we can answer that question by looking at standardized test scores. So for the last two decades, this nation has been obsessed with closing the so-called achievement gap, right? The difference in test scores between some groups of students and others. The goal, in other words, is to fix this group so that they can compete and perform as well as this one. Okay. Well, is that really what we should be doing? One of the biggest names in multicultural education, Gloria Madsen-Billings, argues that this achievement gap is really the tip of a much larger iceberg of racial inequities in education, and that if all you do is focus on the gap in test scores, you miss the much larger problems. Problems like historic segregation, which, by the way, did not end with Brown. It actually really kicked in 10 years later with the Civil Rights Movement. But after about a quarter century of desegregation, we ended the nation's, throughout the country, we began to end desegregation programs. We entered a period of time called resegregation, where students returned to the neighborhood school, and if our neighborhoods are all segregated in this nation, certainly our schools will also be segregated, which means that today, not only have we lost all progress we made during the desegregation movement, it is actually the case, that in some parts of this country, our nations are even more segregated than they were when we began these segregation programs. And what about other big structural problems, inequities in education, like school funding? About 20 years ago, when Jonathan Kozol wrote his fantastic book, Savage Inequalities, Kozol argued that it's possible for a school district in this country to be spending about three times as much per pupil as a district right next door. Why? Because school funding is based on local property taxes. If there's expensive homes in your neighborhood, there's a lot more money going into your nation's schools. Well, this problem has also gotten worse, so that today we can find school districts that are spending more than four times as much per pupil as a district nearby. Why? Because if school funding is based on wealth, let's look at what's going on with wealth in this country. The wealth gap, the difference between the very rich and the very poor, is greater, some are arguing, than when this nation entered the Great Depression almost a century ago, right? Wealth inequities continue to get worse, and it's not surprising then that school funding is also going to continue to get worse. Perhaps one of the most troubling systemic problems in education, however, is the lack of democratic decision-making that we follow. Who's making decisions? Who's driving school reform? Is it educators? Is it even elected officials? No, right? Because increasingly, the people who are driving school reform are those with money. It's the corporations. It's the mega philanthropies like the Gates Foundation, the Broad Foundation, the Walton Family Foundation that experiment with school reforms in the urban districts in the hope of scaling up over time. Why are these not the problems we talk about? Why are we not talking about historic segregation? Why are we not talking about inequitable funding? Why are we not talking about non-democratic, undemocratic, anti-democratic decision-making? I would argue it's because of what Winnier's third question is getting at. What is the story that we're buying into? We need to be asking what has become so commonsensical in our nation's debates that it goes unquestioned, that it masks what's really going on in our nation's schools. One of the stories that we seem to buy into, for example, and it doesn't matter whether you're a Democrat or a Republican, conservative or liberal, many people seem to buy into the story that test scores will tell us everything we need to know. So all of the major reforms happening right now, and and I actually do mean all of the major ones happening right now, are driven by the story that test scores tell us everything we need to know. So let's make decisions about student progress, about teacher evaluation, about closing schools, about universities that prepare teachers, all based on whether or not we see gains in test scores. Even though statisticians themselves are telling us that is a neither valid nor reliable way to make such decisions. There's so many things that are commonsensical that go unquestioned. Why do we run the school year from September to June? Why does the school day run from 8 to 3? Why do we think we should teach 50 minutes of math and 50 minutes of reading and 50 minutes of writing? And why do we even think it's effective to like deliver content by standing in front of a room and talking about stuff for half an hour? Like, why do we do this in education? Why is this the common sense? Right? I'd like to tell the story of how about 100 years ago, it was kind of commonsensical to say that girls should not get too much education. And why did we say that? Well, some people believed that girls belonged in the home. And some people believed that women would compete with men for jobs. But some of you are probably familiar that about 100 years ago, there was a science of the time. There were scientists of that time who were telling us something like this. The mind is connected to the body. And if you mess up one, you might mess up the other. So if girls got too much education, they might go crazy, they might become physically ill, they might even become infertile. So today, many of us look back and we say, wow, that's kind of a crazy idea, like you study too much and you can't have babies, like come up with that, right? About 50 years ago, it was kind of commonsensical to say that you had darker skin, you should not get too much education. And why did we say that? Well, there are some people who believe that there will be competition for jobs. But some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with how about 50 years ago, there was also a science of that time that was telling us something like this. This is how disturbing the science was, right? It's affecting this phase, right? Science of that time was telling us that people of darker skin did not have as much intellectual capacity. This is the whole bell curve argument, right? So why should we waste our time and our resources teaching them? Today, many of us look back and we say, wow, those are kind of crazy ideas. In fact, that's a really kind of racist idea. But my point is that about 50 or 100 years ago, for many people, those stories were just common sense. And I say all of this not to poke fun at people 50 or 100 years ago, but rather to raise the question, 50 years from now, how might we look back at the year 2015 and complete the sentence, I can't believe in 2015 it was common sense to think this. What is the common sense that we're not even seeing that's getting in the way of our ability to address the real problems in education and to come up with better solutions? When I began talking about these issues on policy, someone once came up to me when I first started talking and he said, wow, that was kind of a depressing talk. So from now on, I decided I would end on an up note. So let me, in my last few minutes, give you some next steps, things that I think that we can do to address these larger problems. Let me suggest three things that we need to be doing. One is we need to be reframing the debate. Right? What more important role of educators of public schools than to engage in public education, to engage in raising the consciousness of the public, right? We need to be coming up with new stories. We need to be complicating the stories that are being told in our communities, in our families, in our households, in our schools about what's wrong with education and what we need to do better. My second point is we need to act in solidarity. We need to find more ways to collectivize. Education is a highly individualizing profession. Right? Not only are people like Duncan and King blaming all that's wrong with public education on the shoulders of teachers, this is the whole Michelle Rhee argument, right? The former chancellor of DC Public Schools, who really made her name by arguing that schools are failing. And they're failing because there's too many lazy and incompetent teachers and principals. So what was her claim to fame? She came in and she fired a whole bunch of people. She can't say she increased learning or retention or engagement, but she can say that she demonized teachers and principals, right? Even when we learn to teach, we're often under the impression that my job as a teacher is to close the door and be brilliant in the classroom. All right, that's part of your job. But part of your job is also to find ways to collectivize. And that's another reason, by the way, that I think organizations like Teachers for Social Justice is so vital. because they help us find ways to collectivize. They help us find ways to act as a profession to push back against the problematic reforms underway today. And that's, by the way, why all of you should see this conference as really the part of a year-long engagement. Don't let your engagement with Teachers for Social Justice end when you leave this building. But what does it mean to act in solidarity? Let me give one very concrete suggestion. I would argue that it means that we look after those who are most on the margins in our nation's schools. I once heard one of my mentors say, "How dare you call yourself a leader? How dare you call yourself an advocate for social justice? And for that matter, how dare you call yourself a public school educator? If you are not willing to be on the front lines for those whose differences make you the most uncomfortable." Whose race or skin color conjures up stereotypes in your mind that make you afraid. Children whose status of documented or undocumented make you nervous. Children whose language or accent is so strong that you have difficulty understanding. Children whose disabilities are so severe you don't even know how to interact. Children whose gender presentation or sexual orientation is not what you think is normal. Children who live in such great poverty that they're engaging in survival sex work on the streets to survive. Some of these differences may make certain people in this room uncomfortable. And I would argue that it is those differences that precisely should be the center of our work as social justice educators. Because if we are not looking after those children who the rest of society is willing to give up on, then we should not be in this role in public schools. We should not think only about an action that's going to lead to a policy change. Activism is not simply about holding a rally to change a law. Activism and social change is a result of movements. And let me talk briefly then about the civil rights movement, turning back to people like Rainier, turning back to people like Grace Lee Bones. The civil rights movement has as its centerpiece things like the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Brown v. Board of Education of 1954, Elementary and Secondary Education Act of 1965. All right, many of you are probably aware, though, that even activists at that time were telling us that all of these major victories were actually compromises. They were steps forward and steps back. They were helpful in some ways and not so helpful in others, which means that the civil rights movement was a great change agent in our society, not merely because of these victories, but because they were able to shift the national consciousness. They changed how we as a nation thought about things like race and rights and diversity and democracy and America. Even the Occupy movement didn't lead to any major legislative changes in its wake. What made the Occupy movement so powerful is that it made household language things like the privileged, the masses, the 1%, the 99%. Do we have a similar kind of movement in education? This is what we need to be working towards. We need to be working collectively to shift the public consciousness, to think very differently about what are the problems in our nation's schools and what would be better reforms. This is the work that I urge us to grapple with. These are the questions that I urge us to take seriously as we engage in this important work. I so look forward to many more of these kinds of gatherings where we can do this together. I hope that my presentation today helps in that effort. Thanks very much, everyone.
All right. Woo! I really want to urge all of you to purchase Kevin's book, Against Common Sense, which was a lot of the basis for his talk today. It's in its third edition. He'll be signing it in the hallway out there. So please pass by the USF table, which will be right out there. Kevin will be signing his book, also a book called Bad Teacher that Kevin wrote. So again, one more hand for Kevin Kumashiro. And we're going to pass you off to workshops now. Don't forget the prayer meditation room, which is in room 328. And get to workshops very quickly because they start at 10:45. So 10 minutes passing.